Good evening. Tomorrow we have the Shuso ceremony for Hoshin. Shuso literally means head monk, who is the leader of this 3 months practice period. And the main part of this ceremony is a question and answer between Shuso and the people in the assembly. So tomorrow you can ask any question to him. And the question is about one koan, one particular koan. I hope you know what koan is. And at this time, Hoshin choose the case 52 or from the Book of Serenity or Shoyoroku. Koan collection is based on a few sections. First one is introduction. What is the main point of this koan? And second is the koan itself. And third is the commentary on that koan by the Zen master, Chinese Zen master, who made this text. And the fourth part is the verse or poem about the expression of essence or main point of this koan. And again, there are some commentary on that verse or poem. And my responsibility this evening is to explain what the point of this koan to help you to find a good question. Good question means difficult question to answer. So this evening we don't have question and answer after my talk. When you find a question, ask him tomorrow. Well, this question, as I said, is called Kaoshan's Reality Body. Kaoshan is a name of a Chinese Zen master in our Soto Zen lineage. Kaoshan, let me use his Japanese pronunciation of his name, because I cannot really pronounce Chinese way. His name in Japanese is Sōzan, and his teacher was Tōzan, Tōzan Ryōkai, and our lineage or our school is called Sōtō School or Sōtō Zen, because of these two teachers' names, Sōzan and Tōzan. It's kind of unusual. First, disciple's name is first and teacher's name second. There have been some discussion about what this means, but I don't have time to talk about that. And reality body is an English translation of Dharma body or Dharma Kaya. So first we have to understand what Dharma Kaya is, because this koan is about Dharma Kaya and what the relation between our practice and this Dharma Kaya. When, as you know, Shakyamuni Buddha was the only Buddha in this human world, in the history of human beings, he was born about 2500 years ago in India and lived for about 80 years. He awakened to the reality, and that reality is called Dharma. And in English, we usually write with capital D, Dharma. That is the truth or reality Shakyamuni awakened to. And right after he had this awakening, he thought it's too difficult and too deep and too subtle to explain, to share with other people. So he had no intention or desire to teach, he just found the reality to himself, and that was enough. That was the first he thought. But somehow, Indian god, whose name was Brahma, came to Buddha and asked him to teach, even though the truth or reality was very difficult to share with people, but still there are some people who may understand. So the god asked Buddha to teach. First, two times he said no, he rejected. But when he was asked third time, somehow he said yes. And after that, he stayed by himself, continued to sit under the trees around there. And I think he was thinking how to explain or express the truth or reality he found and to share other people. And after several weeks, he started to walk to the place named Deer Park. There were five monks who used to practice with Shakyamuni. He thought those monks were the best people to explain. So he did it. And somehow he was successful. Those five monks understood and found, experienced the same truth or reality. That was the beginning of the history of Buddhism, and it continued until today. But after teaching about 40 years, when he became 80, he died. And people thought, you know, Buddha, Shakyamuni, and his teaching called Dharma again. And this Dharma is not only one. The truth or reality he found, he discovered, was one. But his way of teaching was not only one. Depending upon to whom he taught, he explained or expressed in different ways. And also depending upon who they are, their understanding might be different. So Buddha's teachings are not singular. It's a collection of many teachings, and people memorize all of them, most of them. And those collection of those teachings became the sutra. And that is called also Dharma. So in a sense, there are two kinds of Dharma. One is that Dharma as truth or reality. And another is the teachings about that truth or reality Buddha discovered. And those two and Buddha, when Buddha taught those five monks, and they understood, they became Buddha's student or disciples. And Buddha continued to teach. So for 40 years, thousands of people became Buddha's disciples and lay people, lay students. And they considered Shakyamuni as a Buddha, our teacher, and the Dharma, truth, or the teachings about that truth. And people who practice with Buddha, called Sangha, they thought those three are three jewels or three treasures. Those are the elements of Buddhism. In Buddhism, Buddha teachings, and student or people who study and practice the teaching are necessary elements. So when Shakyamuni passed away, people in the Sangha had a question, what difficulties? You know, one of three treasures disappeared. And somehow Buddha was very special teacher. They couldn't choose second Buddha. Buddha was the only one, the Shakyamuni Buddha. So I think that was a very serious question for those Buddhist people. And I think from that point they started to think, what is Buddha after Shakyamuni's death? And that means what made that particular person Buddha. And they thought that is Dharma. So even though his body as the five skandhas, five aggregates, that is body and mind, passed away, so disappeared, but the Dharma that makes that five skandhas into Buddha is still there. That was the origin of the idea or concept of Dharmakaya. The Buddha's body and mind, actually Buddha's body and mind is called Rupakaya. Rupa means material. So now they didn't have Rupakaya, but they started to think. Still, Buddha's Dharmakaya is still there. That is the original idea of Dharmakaya. So Dharmakaya originally referred to what Buddha taught, the collection of teachings. But from that point, the Dharmakaya or Dharma body of Buddha, in a sense, grew, and it became bigger and bigger. It's not simply the collection of what Buddha taught as a collection of sentences or languages, but the reality what Buddha taught. So it's not the language, but the truth or reality that language is expressing become Dharmakaya. That is the way things are. That is the origin, the name of this truth or reality Buddha awakened to. That is Dharma. So that reality becomes Dharma. And especially in Mahayana Buddhism, especially in China, that reality is not a concept, but actually, you know, Dharma is the way things are. That is impermanence. Everything is impermanent, and there's no fixed self. That is anatta in Sanskrit, and everything is a collection of different elements. And especially in Mahayana Buddhism, it is said reality of interconnectedness. We are connected with everything. And so especially in Chinese Buddhism, everything, that totality of interconnectedness of everything, and everything within that network of interdependent origination is Dharmakaya. So Dharmakaya is the way things are within this network of the famous analogy of Indra's net. The entirety of Indra's net in which everything is connected is called Dharma or Dharmakaya. And each and everything within that network are also part of Dharmakaya. So Dharmakaya refers to this entire world, entire universe. You know, Dharmakaya Buddha such as Mahavairochana Buddha or in the Kegonkyo Flower Ornament Sutra. Or in the Vajrayana Buddhism, it is called Mahavairochana. Those are that this universe itself is Dharmakaya Buddha. So actually, when Zen, Chinese Zen, Zen teacher discuss about Dharmakaya, that means this entirety of interconnectedness. That is Dharmakaya. And each one of us, not only human beings, but each and every beings in which those are interconnected within this network is, we think that is an individual being, but this individual beings has no fixed entity. This individual being, each and every one of us, which has unique, some uniqueness, can exist only within the relation with the others. So, the relation between each one of us, or each of the beings, that is, of course, plural. I am not you, you are not me, so we are different. There are some individuality. And yet these individual beings can exist as individual unique beings only within relation with others. So how can we express or understand and express the relation between these two sides, individuality and oneness of all beings, is the point of very important point of Mahayana teachings. And the question and answer or the conversation in this koan is really point out what is the relation between Dharmakaya as a totality of all beings and each one of us. So let me read the koan itself. This is a question and answer between the Zen master whose name was Sozan, and he asked a question to his student. And his question was, first he quote a sentence from one Mahayana Buddhist teaching, Buddhist sutras, named Konkokyo. Maybe you don't need to understand what this means. It's just the Mahayana Buddhist sutra. And this particular part, sentence of this within this sutra is kind of to praise the virtue of Buddha, especially the Dharmakaya Buddha. And the sentence from that sutra saying is as follows. The Buddha's true reality body, reality body is a translation of Dharmakaya or Dharma body. So I like Dharma body instead of reality body, so that we use Dharma body. The Buddha's true Dharma body is like a space, empty space. It manifests form in response to being, to each and every individual beings, in response to beings, like the moon in the water, So Dharma body is like a moonlight, and each individual beings are like, you know, this is one of the source of Dogen's expression in Genjo Koan. The boundless moonlight is reflecting itself in each and every tiny drop of water. So basically, this is the same thing as Dogen said in Genjo Koan. So let me read the sentence again. The Buddha's true Dharma body is like a space. It manifests form. So Buddha body, Dharma body has no form, but somehow Dharma body manifests itself as each and every form. And that is like a moon in the water. So he quotes this sentence from the sutra, and then he asked, how do you explain the principle of response? Why Dharma body respond to each and every being? How this, you know, the corresponding or working together or even interpenetrating of Dharmakaya and each individual beings are happening. That is the question. How do we explain the principle of response between the entirety and part of it? Then the student said, his answer was, like an us looking in a wall. Us? That is, I like donkey. A donkey, an animal. The donkey is looking at a wall. So we are donkey. And well, not wall, well. Donkey is looking at the well. So within the well, donkey's face is reflected. In this case, this round shape of well is like a Indra's net in which everything is connected. And when donkey look at that well, his face is reflected. But donkey is, I'm not sure it's true or not, but donkey has no thinking. We have thinking. So we are deluded. So when we see something like a well, we start to think, what is this? You know, this things happening within this universe, and we interpret, and we create a theory, and we have to, not have to, but we do sometimes separate things, and evaluate things, define and evaluate things, and I think this part, I think I don't like that part, or this is important, that is not important, or this is wrong, or right or bad, or good. That kind of so-called picture of the world is made with our subjective way of viewing things, and we make judgment. That is how we create a kind of a very incomplete copy of the reality itself. It from our point of view, human point of view. But because donkey doesn't have that kind of work or function of like human brain, so donkey just looking. Now, without making the distorted copy or making discrimination and evaluation. Just so donkey just seeing, look, watching the whale without making anything. You know, then the master saw them, said, "You said a lot indeed, but you only said 80%. So you are saying is not complete, perfect. Somehow 20% less than the reality." So he said, "You have to say more." But the student couldn't say anything more than this. So he asked, "What about you, teacher? How do you explain or express, you know, this relation between Dharma body and each one of individual phenomenal beings?" Then the master said, "Like the whale looking at the donkey." The student said, "Donkey sees the whale." But this the master says, "Whale sees the donkey." What is the difference? What is the 20%? This is the point of the question. What is the difference between donkey see the whale and whale see the donkey? If you are familiar with Dogen's Genjo Koan, Dogen very clearly said about the same relation. You know, he said, you know, each one of us is a self. And we are living together with so-called myriad dharmas, all beings. And Dogen said, to convey, to carry ourselves, each one of us, carry ourselves to the myriad dharmas and carry out practice realization is delusion. So when we take this to the myriad dharmas, that is interconnectedness, and see it, understand it, and more than understanding, we want to get it, we want to make it my position. Dogen said that is delusion. But when myriad dharmas, all beings, came to the self and allow the self to carry out practice, study and practice, is realization. So according to Dogen, whether deluded or delusion and realization is within how we relate ourselves to myriad dharmas. And if we try to convey ourselves toward myriad dharmas and to observe it and think about it and make a copy of that reality and try to do something based on that reality, then according to Dogen, that is delusion. But what this monk answered is donkey, not human beings. So donkey has no such function of brain to make a distorted copy of Dharmakaya. Donkey is just seeing. So that's the difference between donkey and what we usually do when we see the web. So we are more like a monkey, not donkey. And we see the reflection of ourselves and make evaluation and judgment. But donkey doesn't. So donkey is just being donkey. But still, you know, the self is doing something toward the world. So the fat teacher said, the world see the donkey. It's same as Dogen said, the myriad dharmas come toward the self and allow the self to practice, to study and practice. In that case, in Dogen's expression, you know, this self is body and mind, five skandhas. And when we try not to convey or carry this being toward myriad dharmas, but myriad dharmas come toward the self, at that point, according to Dogen, when we sit facing the wall and letting go of our thinking, and our thinking is the function of making the distorted copy of the reality, then we let go. Then we are simply one with myriad dharmas, or we are simply the part of myriad dharmas. But when we start to think, we become the subject, and myriad dharmas become object, and we try to think and try to control. That is delusion according to Dogen. So this just sitting and letting go of whatever coming up in our mind is like a donkey. Donkey seeing the world. But if we think I'm seeing the world, but still I'm here and myriad dharmas is there. So still there is a separation and relation between the self and myriad dharmas, and so it's still delusion. So we have to say, not a donkey see even donkey see, not donkey see the whale, but whale see the donkey. That means because the donkey is from the very beginning, this part of myriad dharmas. So even when we let go of our thought, well, even when we don't convey ourselves toward myriad dharmas, within the myriad dharmas, we are already there. So our zazen is like a the whale seeing the donkey. So that is the point, and that is in Dogen's expression, that is called body and mind dropping off. Or dropping off body and mind means the separation between self and all other beings within this interconnectedness is dropped off. So this one network of all beings is simply being there. And by letting go of our distorted copy, we, in a sense, we simply participate within this movement or functioning of interconnectedness. So we are really part of this Dharmakaya. So only Dharmakaya is there. Or we can say even Dharmakaya is not there. Only things happening simply. And that is the way things are. Well, that is my understanding of this conversation. So now I introduce the verse or the poem about this conversation. the verse was written by another Chinese master whose name was Wanshi Shougaku. The poem is as follows. The ass or the donkey looks at the well, and the well looks at the donkey. Wisdom is all embracing. Purity pervades with abundance. Behind the elbow, who discern the sea? In the house, no books are kept. The room threads aren't strong. The work of the shuttle, the pattern going vertically and horizontally, the meaning is distinct of itself. Let me read it again. The donkey looks at the well. The well looks at the donkey. Wisdom is all embracing. Purity pervades with abundance. Behind the elbow, who discern the seal? In the house, no books are kept. The loom threads aren't strong, the work of the shuttle, the pattern going vertically and horizontally, the meaning is distinct of itself. So first two lines is just repetition of a donkey looks at the well, and the well looks at the donkey. So I don't need to talk about this. And the second, next two sentences. Wisdom is all embracing. Purity pervades with abundance. It means there's no separation within this entire network. This no separation is wisdom. Wisdom is all embracing. It means no separation, no exclusion. So this entirety of Indra's net is itself wisdom or prajna. In this case, this prajna or wisdom is a wisdom which sees emptiness of all things. Emptiness, equality, and oneness, non-duality of all beings. So this wisdom is all embracing. And actually, this network of interdependent origination, dependent origination, is itself wisdom. Yeah, because there's no such observer which sees how the things are as an object. So, Buddha's Dharmakaya, Dharma body, it is itself wisdom, which embraces or includes all beings. No observer. So purity pervades with abundance. Purity is the opposition of defilement. Defilement is our three poisonous mind and all other feelings or desires influenced with those three poisonous mind. That is greed, anger or hatred, and ignorance. Then we see things, all dharmas. Somehow there are something we like or we don't like, or something which is seems variable or not variable. That is how our mind creates that kind of a copy of the media dharmas. And we make choice. This is good, so I want to get there, and I don't like that, so I want to stay away from those things. So we start to run after what we want, what we like, or what is what we see, think more important, and we escape from what we don't like or something negative. So our life become running, running after something or escaping from something, and that is called samsara. So there's no peaceful abiding. We need to only or always chasing after something or escaping from something. That is almost always our life, what we do within our life. Where can we find our peacefulness or our stability is the point of this teaching. And so this purity means purity within, when there's no distinction or discrimination or separation, there's no way those three poisonous mind control us. When we are really letting go of our thought, not only intellectual thinking, but thought in this case means everything happening within psychology, within our mind. When we let go and we simply become part of this in Dogen's expression, total function of this interconnectedness, then purity or non-defilement pervade everywhere. The point is such a thing possible within our actual life, day-to-day life? So that is one question you need to ask to Hoshi tomorrow. And next two lines are behind the elbow who discern the sea. To me, this sentence is really difficult to understand what this means. Especially one Chinese character in this translation translated as discern. Discern is like to see or to understand. That is one of the meaning of this Chinese character. But another meaning of the same Chinese character is to separate. To separate and share. And most of the commentary I read in Japanese interpret in that way. That means, this reality or Dharma body cannot be separated into two pieces and share with other people. Like, in Zen tradition, we think Dharma has been transmitted from one teacher to next, and it has been transmitted from Shakyamuni in India to us actually. So we think there is something we can transmit, we can give and receive. To do so, we need to be some kind of separation. I can separate part of my Dharma and give it to you. But there's no such things possible because this is simply one reality. So according to that interpretation, this means this Dharma body or reality or wisdom cannot be separate and transmit or share with others. And this behind the elbow, who the seal of the seal that is behind of elbow, I don't understand what this means. In the commentary, there's some explanation, but I don't really understand. But it seems there's something important behind the elbow. I don't know what this is. It's like a talisman. Talisman? I don't know what talisman behind the elbow means in Chinese culture. But it seems there's something very important is there. And each one of us has it our own. So there's no way to share with others. So that means we have to find by ourselves. We cannot share with others, or even teacher cannot give to his student. We need to really search and find and understand and live out that reality. There's no such way to share with others. And next line is, in the house no books are kept. This came from another dialogue. It said that in one family there was a boy or child who knows everything. This is a conversation between Ungan and his disciple Tozan. Tozan was Sozan's teacher. Anyway, this means this boy, this child knows everything. So Tozan asks how many books they have in the family, because the children know everything. But Ungan said they have completely no book at all. That means this prajna or wisdom has nothing to do with the collection of that kind of knowledge. That is, so no matter how many books we read and accumulate our knowledge about Dharmakaya, it's not about Dharmakaya itself. So that's why we have to practice. We have to see with our own eyes instead of reading and thinking. So reading and thinking and talking like this and hearing, so this is really meaningless thing. But somehow we need to do this meaningless thing in order to understand this is meaningless. So this is another point to ask to Hoshin tomorrow. Why do we do such a meaningless thing? And finally, final two lines are the loom threads aren't strong. Loom is weaving machine, and within this weaving machine there are no threads. But somehow the shuttle, you know the shuttle, right? Shuttle is working, but there's no thread. Kind of strange thing, but the person, the Zen master who composed this poem says things happening within this real universe is like a loom without thread, but somehow it's working. Shuttle is moving, and the pattern going vertically and horizontally. You know, weaving machine create the fabric with certain patterns. And often, especially in this the master's teaching verse, you know, vertical, horizontal thread considered as time, and vertical thread considered as a space. So within time and space, you know, like a scenario of four seasons, in each season or even each day, the scenery or pattern is changing. But that is happening with that thread. We don't see the thread. So we think each and every being are individual and independent, but somehow with that thread, this is this loom or weaving machine is working. and the pattern made by this threadless weaving machine is distinct of itself, means there's no designer and no person who is working on the loom. And so this is really automobile machine. And there's no thread in that machine. And yet things are changing and moving around, working together. That is how Dharma body is working within this phenomenal world. And we are part of that, you know, weaving. I think that is the meaning of this koan and this verse. I think that's enough today. So if you have any question, please ask a question tomorrow.